All right, welcome back to another episode of the Greatest Book Club in the World. Thank you, Book Club. Yeah. And today we are on a special day, on a special episode, on a special day. This is Sunday, and which means, and this means that we are on the start of the new week, on five episodes of ongoing to come on this week. So yeah, I'm extremely excited about it. And besides that, it is a new week. It's time for a new series. After last week, we finished doing The Impossible by Patrick Bet-David. There are 25 laws to do for achieving the impossible. By the way, it was a great series. You definitely want to watch it. Today, we are going to start a new series, a new book, and it's called Start With Why by Simon Sinek. It's like a really famous TED lecture. The speech, and now we are going to read together this book, and I hope to learn a lot from it. And if you are new to the channel, I welcome. My name is AK, and I'm your host. And if you are familiar with the channel, so I'm glad to see you all again. And what we are doing in this channel, we are going to read together this great book, Start With Why. And I hope to, by doing this, I hope to inspire other people around the world to speak in English and to work on it in English and to work on their talent and to gain more confidence to stand in front of the camera. Because as you see, I'm doing this by personal example, because I am not an English native speaker. And I don't have the most expensive studio to record myself. I just have a regular web camera, and this is my studio, a green screen, and I'm just in my bedroom, just record myself on each day, and that's it. I have to inspire the people all around the world to speak in English and to work with in English, because I believe that English is the number one tool that each one of us must require in order to be successful in life. Yeah, you can be successful without English, but if you want to achieve great things and international things, you definitely want to know English. And that's it. By the way, say to my nice friend over here, she also wanted to start to say why you should subscribe to the channel, because this is the greatest channel in the world. This is the greatest, this is going to be the greatest time of your life. So you definitely want to subscribe, like and follow this channel, and comment below what is your favorite part from this episode. My friend, she's coming from a site called Good Fun, and you can find the link to it in the description below. I'm also going to add a link to Simon Sinek social media platforms and account, so make sure to check him out. And without any more further introduction, let's start. So start with why. How great leaders inspire everyone to take action, Simon Sinek. And today, for Victoria, who finds good ideas and makes them great. And today we are going to do the introduction of this book. There are leaders and there are those who lead. Leaders hold a position of power or influence. Those who lead inspire us. Whether individuals or organizations, we follow those who lead not because we have to, but because we want to. We follow those who lead not for them, but for ourselves. This is a book for those who want to inspire others and for those who want to find someone to inspire them. Introduction. Why start with why? Let's see. This book is about a naturally occurring pattern, a way of thinking, acting, and communicating that gives some leaders the ability to inspire those around them. And for these natural born leaders may have come into the world with a predisposition to inspire. I think it's like a kind of talent that you're born with. The ability is not reserved for them the ability is not reserved for them exclusively. We can all learn this pattern. With a little discipline, any leader organization can inspire others, both inside and outside the organization, to help advance their ideas and their vision. We can all learn to lead. The goal of this book is not simply to try to fix the things that aren't working. Rather, I wrote this book as a guide to focus on and amplify the things that do work. I do not aim to upset the solutions offered by others. Most of the answers we get, when based on sound evidence, when based on sound evidence, are perfectly valid. However, if we are starting with the wrong questions, if we don't understand the cause, then even the right answers will always steer us wrong. Eventually, the truth, you see, is always revealed. Eventually. The stories that follow are of those individuals and organizations that naturally embody this pattern. They are the ones that start with why. 1. The goal was ambitious. Public interest was high. Experts were eager to contribute. Money was readily available. Armed with every ingredient for success, Samuel Pierpont Langley set out in the early 1900s to be the first man to pilot an airplane. Highly regarded, he was a senior officer at the Smithsonian Institutions, a mathematics professor who had also worked at Harvard. His friend included some of the most powerful men in government and business, including Andrew Carnegie and Alexander Graham Bell. Langley was given a $50,000 grant from the Harvard Department to fund this project. A tremendous amount of money for the time. He put together the best minds of the day. A veritable dream team of talent and know-how. Langley and his team used the finest materials, and the press followed him everywhere. People all over the country were invited to the story, waiting to read that he had achieved his goal. With the team he had gathered and ample resources, his success was guaranteed. Or was it? R-I-V-E-T-E-D. Revealed it. If you know what this sport means, please let me know in the comment below. A few hundred miles away, Bilbo and Orville Wright were working on their own flying machine. Their passion to fly was so intense that it inspired the intuition and commitment of a dedicated group in their hometown of Dayton, Ohio. There was no funding for their venture, no government grants, no high-level connections. Not a single person on the team had an advanced degree or even a college education. Not even Wilbur or Orville. But the team banded Blended together in a Ambon bicycle shop and made the vision real. On December 17, 1993, a small group witnessed a man take flight for the first time in history. How did the Bright Brothers succeed? Were better equipped, better funded, and better educated team could not. It wasn't luck. Both the Bright Brothers and Langley were highly motivated. Both had a strong work ethic. Both had keen scientific minds. They were pursuing exactly the same goal, but only the Bright Brothers were able to inspire those around them and truly lead their team to develop a technology that would change the world. Only the Wright brothers stand with why, too. In 1965, students on the campus of the University of California, Berkeley, were the first to publicly burn their draft cards to protest Americans' involvement in the Vietnam War. Northern California was a hotbed of anti-government and anti-establishment sentiment. Footage of clashes and riots in Berkeley and Oakland was beamed around the globe, fueling sympathetic movements across the United States and Europe. But it wasn't until 1976, Nearly three years after the end of America's military involvement in the Vietnam conflict, that a different revolution originated. They aimed to make an impact, a very big impact, even challenge the way people perceived how the world worked. But these young revolutionaries did not throw stones or take up arms against an authoritarian regime. Instead, they decided to beat the system at its own game. For Steve Wozniak and Steve Jobs, the co-founders of Apple Computer, the battlefield was business and the weapon of choice and the weapon of choice was the personal computer. The personal computer revolution was beginning to grow when Wozniak built the Apple One. Just starting to gain attention, the technology was primarily seen as a tool for business. Computers were too complicated and out of the price range of the average individual. But Wozniak, a man not motivated by money, envisioned a nobler purpose for the technology. He saw the personal computer as a way for the little man to take on a corporation. If he could figure out a way to get it in the hands of the individual, he thought, the computer would give nearly everyone the ability to perform many of the same functions as a vastly better resourced company. The personal computer could level the playing field and change the way the world operated. Both designed the Apple One and improved the technology with the Apple II to be affordable and simple to use. No matter how visionary or how brilliant, a great idea or a great product isn't worth much if no one buys it. Wozniak's best friend at the time, the 21-year-old Steve Jobs, knew exactly what to do. He had experience selling Simplus Electronics parts, Jobs would prove to be much more than a good salesman. He wanted to do something significant in the world, and building a company was how he was going to do it. Apple was a tool he used to ignite his revolution. In the first year in business, with only one product, Apple made $1 million in revenues. By year two, they did $10 million in sales. In the fourth year, they sold $100 million worth of computers. Damn! And in just 6 years, Apple Computer was a $1 billion company with over 3,000 employees. Wow. Jobs and Bose were not the only people taking part in the personal computer revolution. They weren't the only smart guys in the business. In fact, they didn't know much about business at all. What made Apple special was not their ability to build such a fast growth company. It wasn't their ability to think differently about personal computers. But what has made Apple special is that they have been able to repeat the pattern over and over and over. Unlike any of their competitors, Apple has successfully challenged the conventional thinking with the computer within the computer industry. The small electronics industry, the music industry, the mobile phone industry, and the broader entertainment industry. And the reason is simple. Apple inspires. Apple starts with why. Number three. He was not perfect. He had his complexities. He was not the only one who suffered in a pre-civil rights America, and there were plenty of other charismatic speakers. But Martin Luther King Jr. had a gift in order to inspire people. Dr. King knew that if the civil rights movement was to succeed, if there was to be a real lasting change, excuse me, it would take more than him and his closest allies. It would take more than rousing words and eloquent speeches. It would take people, tens of thousands of average citizens, united by a single vision, to change the country. At 11 a.m. on August 28, 1963, they would send a message to Washington that it was time for America to steer a new course. The organizers of the civil rights movement did not send out thousands of invitations. The organizers of the civil rights movement did not send out thousands of invitations, nor was there a website to check the date. But the people came, and they kept coming and coming. All told, a quarter of a million people descended from the nation's capital in time to hear the words immortalized by history, delivered by the man who would lead a movement that would change America forever. I have a dream. The ability to attract so many people from across the country, of all colors and races, to join together on the right day, at the right time, talk something special. Though others knew what had to change in America to bring about civil rights for all, it was Martin Luther King was able to inspire a country to change not just for the good of a minority, but for the good of everyone. Martin Luther King started with why. Zemar leaders and there are those who lead. With only 6% market, with only 6% market share in the United States and about 3% worldwide, Apple is not a leading manufacturer of home computers. Yet the company leads the computer industry and is now a leader in others, in other in the industries as well. Martin Luther King, Eric Luther King's experiences were not unique, yet he inspired the nation to change. The Wright brothers were not the strongest contenders in the race to take the first manned private flight, but they led us into a new era of aviation, and in doing so, completely change the world we live in. Their goals were not different than everyone else's, and their systems and processes were easily replicated. Yet the Wright brothers, Apple and Martin Luther King, stand out among their peers. They stand apart from the norm, and their impact is not easily copied. They are members of a very select group of leaders who do something very, very special. They inspire us. Just about every person or organization needs to motivate others to act for some reasons or another. Someone to motivate a purchase decision. Others are looking for support or a vote. Still, others are keen to motivate the people around them to work harder or smarter, or just follow the rules. The ability to motivate people is not, in itself, difficult. It is usually tied to some external factor. Something incentivizes, or the threat of punishment, will often indicate the behavior we desire. General Motors, for example, so successfully motivated people to buy the products that they sold more cars than any other automaker in the world for over 77 years. Though they were leaders in their industry, they did not lead. Great leaders, in contrast, are able to inspire people to act. Those who are able to inspire give people a sense of purpose or belonging that has little to do with any external incentive or benefit to be gained. Those who truly lead are able to create a following of people who act not because they were swayed, but because they were inspired. For those who are inspired, the motivation to act is deeply personal. They are less likely to be swayed by incentives. Those who are inspired are willing to pay a premium or endure inconvenience, even personal suffering. Those who are able to inspire will create a following of people, supporters, voters, customers, workers. Work for the good of the world, not because they have to, but because they want to. Though relatively few in number, the organizations and leaders with the natural ability to inspire us come in all shapes and sizes. They can be found in both the public and the private sectors. They are in all sorts of industries, selling to consumers, or to other businesses. Regardless of where they exist, they all have a disproportionate amount of influence in their industries. They have the most loyal customers and the most loyal employees. זה tend to be more profitable than others in the industry. They are more innovative, and most importantly, they are able to sustain all those things over the long term. Many of them change the industries, Some of them even change the world. The Wright brothers, Apple and Dr. Luth and Dr. King are just three examples. Harley Davidson, Disney and Southwest Airlines are three more. John F. Kennedy and Ronald Reagan were also able to inspire. No matter from where they hail, they all have something in common. All the inspiring leaders and companies, regardless of size or industry, think, act, and communicate exactly. And it's in the complete opposite of everyone else. What if we could all learn to think, act, and communicate like those who inspire? I imagine a world in which the ability to inspire is practiced not just by a chosen few, but by the majority. Studies show that over 80% of Americans do not have their dream job. If more know how to build organizations that inspire, we could live in a world in which that statistics was the reverse, a world in which over 80% of people love their jobs. People who love going to work are more productive and more creative. They go home happier and have happier families. They treat their colleagues and clients and customers better. Inspired employees make for stronger companies and stronger economies. That is why I wrote this book. I hope to inspire others to do the things that inspire them so that together we might build the companies, the economy, and the world in which trust and loyalty are the norm and not the expectation. This book is not designed to tell you what to do or how to do it. Its goal is not to give you a course of action. Its goal is to offer you the cause of action. For those who have an open mind for new ideas, who seek to create long-lasting success, and who believe that your success requires the aid of others, I offer you a challenge. From now on, start with why. So guys, this is the episode of today. So that I didn't have so much energy as usual, because I'm extremely tired today, because I decided to start to work on myself and to get up early, than usual to get up early, and to go to sleep earlier than I usually do. So now I need to adjust myself. So this is why I'm a little bit less energetic than usual. But anyway, this is what the episode of today. I am really excited about this book. It looks like an easy book to read, with a lot of nice idea. I love this kind of books. And it looks like smart ideas that we can work with. So guys, thank you very much for joining me. I hope to see you, me and my friend, hope to see you all tomorrow for next episode, and we are going to start with part one. Assume you know, part one, a world that doesn't start with why. This is part one of the book. We're going to start with part one, so David did the introduction. So I hope to see you all tomorrow for part one of Start With Why by Simon Sinek. Thank you very much for joining me. Stay safe, stay home until this COVID time is behind us. have a great life in spite of the world. Take care of yourself, and I hope to see you all tomorrow. And until then, have a great time, and bye-bye.